all over the world, from the UK, from Africa, from Europe. We love you. We thank God so much for you, our online community, online church. We thank God for all our friends in the Middle East, in Canada. God is so good. We are so blessed to bring the word of God unto you. So today I'm going to share the message with the title, Are You Ready? Are You Ready? And I'm using this message today based on the events that are going on in our world today. And, you know, it is so easy, brother Nas, to, you know, to just get carried away, you know, with, you know, life and, you know, with a career, with what's going on, you know, day to day, the 9 to 5. And, you know, God's going to do this. God's going to do this for you. And we forget the main thing. The main thing, why are we really here? And the events that happened this week, like I shared with most of you, I lost a cousin that I grew up with for a long time. You know, this guy just loved me so much. His name was Alex, and he just wanted to be with me. You know, he was older, but, you know, he just loved me. So I would stay with him, you know, every now and then. So even when I grew up, he would check on me, you know, and it was just a shock because he wasn't sick. You know, he just got the sickness. They told me in about 2 days, he was gone. And then the next day, the church that I used to go to, that I used to minister, Liberty Worship Center in Uganda, the husband to the pastor, he passed away also almost immediately. You know, he wasn't sick for a long time. And, you know, it just brought a lot of perspective to me, but also to us as a people, because many times, you know, we're just in the rhythm. We are going. And many times we even lose the purpose of why we are going. But we just, you know, it's just the wheel is turning. We are on the next thing. What next? After we achieve this thing, we try to do the next thing. And, you know, we're just on the motion. And the thing is that there is a purpose why we're here. And what is the purpose? Are we just born to be, you know, like I say all the time, are we just born, you know, to be born, go to school, graduate, get married, have some kids, die, and, you know, is that just the only purpose? But we know that we're not only born to be here, but we also have a final destination. We know, I shared a message a few days ago about times and seasons, and I say that, you know, for everything, there is a time and a season. And the scripture told us in Ecclesiastes that there is a time to be born, there is a time to die, there is a time to laugh, there is a time to, you know, to not laugh, there is a time to gather, there is a time to scatter. And when you get the concept that we live in a time of seasons, we are going to live our lives with purpose. We are going to live our lives with intention. And if I'm not going to say God forbid, but if at any moment God decides to call you home, you are ready to meet him. Amen. Because you have to understand that we are created in his image. We belong to him. We don't belong to ourselves. And the scripture was telling us in the Bible study on Wednesday that he called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. So God not only, you know, has called us to live here and you know that's the end of it. No, he wants us back. That is why Jesus said that I'm going to prepare a place for you, so that where I am, there you will be also. And he said, if it wasn't so, I wouldn't have told you. So there is a place that we are going, but the question is, are you ready? Am I ready? Are you ready, First Lady Pam? You know, because many times we get so comfortable here. We get so comfortable and we forget that we have a place we are going. And that today I just wanted us to go back just a little bit. I wanted us to go back just a little bit to put things into perspective. You know, why did Jesus even come? The scripture says that he came to save us. He came to restore relationship. Why does he want to restore relationship? So that when the time comes, now, he wants us to have relationship with him right now while we're still here. But most importantly, when we live here, there is a place. And not the unfortunate thing is that it's not one place. There is two places. You're either going to God or you're going to the place of destruction, that is prepared for the devil and his demons. So there is two places. So it doesn't end here. So we have to be ready. We have to be prepared that if God says your time is up, you are ready. And I was listening to the service today, and one of the men of God was saying that the interesting thing about the departure process from earth is that there is no warning sign. Now, for some people, you know, who have like a long-term illness, you probably know. But let's say somebody dies in an accident, or, you know, just like COVID has been happening, people die within 1 day, 2 days. You know, there is no time to even say goodbye. There is no time to write a will. There is no time to bid farewell to your loved ones. So we need to be ready. And as children of God, as a church, we need to be prepared all the time. Amen. Because none of us knows the time of the hour. And we've seen, I don't know if it was you telling me that kids, young kids have been dying. Children at university, students at university, young people with promise. And just like the pastor who just passed away, Pastor Tom, this was a healthy guy. He had some money, you know, he had his family, he had a ministry. You could just say that he had a lot in his future. But guess what? God say it is time. And when the time is up, you know, it's time to go. But the question is, are you ready? And today, for everybody listening to us today, I want to pose the same question unto you. Are you ready? When the Lord calls you, are you ready? And as we read our scriptures today, we're going to start from Ephesians chapter 5, verse 27. Amen. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 27. That's where we're going to start from. And it's just going to help us. It's just going to help us to, you know, put some things into perspective so that we are not taken by surprise. So that when the Lord calls, we don't find ourselves in a place that we were not supposed to be. Amen. All right. So let's start from actually, I apologize. It's Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 to 2. It says, now about the times and seasons, brothers, we do not need to write to you, for you are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. Amen. The day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. And now what here Paul is trying to talk about, he's talking about the rapture, where Jesus is going to come up in the clouds with the blow of the trumpet. And he says the dead in Christ are going to rise up first. And now the ones who are living will be carried up as well. Now that's what he's talking about. But you have to understand too, this was written over 2,000 years ago. And the rapture hasn't happened to this day. But guess what? People have been dying. People have been meeting the Lord. So whether you go in the rapture or not, you know, it's going to happen. Either you're going to die a natural death, either, you know, whichever way you're going to die, you're probably going to die. But if the Lord tarries, if the Lord waits, we are going to be carried into the rapture. But so that's what Paul is writing here to the Thessalonians. He says, for you are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. To our brothers who have passed away, my cousin who passed away, and I thank God that he gave his life to Jesus before he died. You know, he was a living Christian, you know, I think for the last 3 years. And like for Pastor Tom, and I saw other pastors, I've seen pastors on social media who have died because they're in contact with people all the time. And so that was the day of the Lord for them. They will never, you know, experience that, you know, they will experience the rapture because the dead in Christ will rise up first. Indeed, they will. But they're not here with us right now. So their day came. So when your day comes, my brother and sister, are you going to be ready? And so in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, let's go to verse 3 to 6. It says, while people are saying peace and security, destruction will come upon them suddenly. While people are preaching peace and security, destruction will come upon them suddenly, like labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. Amen. And now he's trying to give us a picture of how it's going to happen in the time of the rapture. But we've seen this happen in Italy. We've seen this happen in India. We've seen this happen during the pandemic. People were just dying like flies, you know, and nobody knew what was going on. And it says that they will not escape. Verse number 4, it says, but you brothers are not in the darkness, so that this day should overtake you like a thief. You brothers, talking about you and I, brothers and sisters, this day should not find us as if we are living in darkness. Verse number 5, it says, for you are all sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as the others do, but let us remain awake and sober. Amen. Child of God, Church of God, we need to remain awake and sober. Amen. The Lord may not tell you that, hey, get your house in order. The way he used to tell people in the Bible, the Lord will send a prophet in the Bible days and say, hey, get your house in order. You are going back home. And then they would, you know, say goodbye. They would install a successor, an heir. But these days, people die in accidents. And I just thank God the devil had a plot on us. Me and my son coming to church, that could have ended us. If you saw how big that truck was, it could have ended us. But we need to be ready. We need to be awake so that when the Lord says it is time, you are ready to go back home. Amen. We need to be ready. And I thought, you know, I was supposed to start a new series today, but I was asking God, what should I talk about in these times when there is fear, when there is uncertainty? And the Lord led me to this message that we should be awake. We should be sober because we do not know when the Lord is going to call us home. Amen. Hallelujah. And so as we're being ready, we need to put some things in place. There are certain things we need to put in order in our lives. Amen. And during our Bible study on Wednesday, I was talking about how God was telling Solomon that if there is a crisis, if there is a calamity, if there is a pandemic, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves, if they seek my face, if they pray, I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. And the key here, because we go straight to the I will heal their land, but it says if they humble themselves, if they seek my face, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal. I'll hear what they're praying, I'll hear their prayers, and I will heal their land. And God isn't only wanting us to come to him in a time of crisis like now, because we are in a world crisis. Man, I had a book tour planned out. I was going to Europe. I had people preparing for me in London, in Amsterdam. You know, I had in South Africa, you know, up to now. And this thing is just dragging on. And I'm like, God, when is this thing going to go away? But, you know, so we're not just praying that God will take away this calamity so that we go back to our old ways. God is calling us to change our lives. Amen. God is calling us to put our lives in order. And then the scripture here says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28, he says, he who has been stealing must steal no more, but must work, doing good with his own hands, that he may have something to share with one in need. And let me just go into the some of the verses here, because they were so interesting, because they get to tell us what we need to do in order to be in line, so that when the Lord calls us, we're not into another, you know, direction, that we're in the right place doing the right thing, so that when the Lord calls us, there is no spot, there is no blemish, and we are just ready to be with him. Amen. So if you can, in the same verse, Ephesians chapter 4, let's start from verse 20, because I think this is very, very powerful. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20, and we're going to go all the way down to 30. It says, but this is not the way you came to know Christ. Surely you heard of him and you were taught in him, in keeping with the truth that is in Jesus. Listen, verse number 22.
Wait, did you say Ephesians?
Yes, Ephesians.
Chapter
4.
Chapter 4.
Yes, chapter 4. And we are You can start from 17 if you want for your notes, but for now we're reading from verse 20 and we're going to go all the way to verse 20, verse 30. Amen. So Ephesians chapter 4 from verse 20 says, but this is not the way you came to know Christ. Surely you heard him and were taught in him. Listen, you were taught in him in keeping with the truth that is in Jesus. Verse 22, to put off your former way of life. Amen. Your old self. All of us have some old ways, certain things we used to do. So God is telling us we need to put off the former self. Amen. The old self, the old habits. Listen, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. 23, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Amen. So God wants us to put off the old ways, put off the old habits, put off the old things we used to do over and over again, and now to be into the image of his son Jesus Christ. And he says to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness. Amen. To be in true righteousness and holiness, because our God is holy. Amen. Verse 25, it says, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood. Amen. Each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor. This is not the time to play around, brothers and sisters. This is not the time to lie to one another. Pastors, this is not the time to lie to people. This is the time to preach the true word of God the way it is. COVID has shown us it is not a respecter of persons. It doesn't matter how much money you have, it cannot save you. It doesn't matter how much insurance you have, it cannot save you. Only God is able to save us, but we need to go back in line. Amen. And if there is something God is telling us as a church, it's now to go back in line and be true Christians. Be in true righteousness and holiness. Amen. This is the gospel that I grew up on about holiness. Amen. If you sinned, they wouldn't even let you touch a microphone. You know, they wouldn't let you even do anything in the church. But now we just left all that stuff. That is old fashioned. That's what we say. But God is calling us back to holiness. Amen. God is calling us back to truth. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. So our verse 25 says, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one another. In other words, there is no reason to lie to one another. There is no reason to hate one another. There is no reason to have secret competitions. There is no reason to have wrangles, to have drama, to have all these things between pastors and pastors, Christian and Christians, sister against sister, brother against brother. This is not the time for those games. Amen. He says that, for we are all members of one another. We are members of one body. Amen. Verse 26, it says, be angry, yet do not sin. Amen. It is okay to be angry. You're going to be angered by people, by your people at work, by your spouse, by your children. He says, but do not sin. Amen. He says, do not let the sun set upon your anger. 27, and do not give the devil a foothold. In other words, don't give the devil a chance. Amen. We are not giving the devil any chance at all. Listen, 28. He who has been stealing must steal no more, but must work, doing good with his own hands, that he may have something to share with the one in need. 29. Let no unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building up the one in need and bringing grace to those who listen. In other words, the words we say matter. The kind of conversations we engage in matter. We're not supposed to be engaging in everything. Whatever joke is on our Facebook, on Instagram, we put in our comments. Whatever, when they're talking about somebody, you add, you know, stuff in there. You add in the comments. You add more fire to the, you know, you add more fuel to the fire. God has called us to be holy. God has called us to be different. Amen. Amen. So even what we say, is very, very, very important. It says that whatever we say should be helpful to build up those who are in need and bringing grace to those who listen. Amen. Verse 13 says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Listen, verse 31. Get rid of all bitterness. Amen. You don't want God to call you when you're bitter. You're having all these grudges against people. Get rid of all bitterness. Listen now. Rage. Rage. You have this rage. Nobody can tell you anything. You just counter. You can't listen to any kind of criticism. You know, somebody gets in front of you on the highway and you're ready to smash them. Amen. 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 So we need to get, it says, the scripture is saying, not me. It says, get rid of all rage and anger. Anger is dangerous. I have seen husbands killing their wives out of anger. Not because they didn't love them, because they got so mad and they just pulled out the gun and just finished them and the kids. We see this on the news all the time. Amen. But we need to get rid of all these things. Amen. He says outcry and slander. You know, putting stuff on people, putting dirt on people, slandering people. We need to get rid of all these things. Listen, along with every form of malice, being malicious. There's some people who are just malicious. They will just make sure they just, you know, put your name in dirt and just, you know, do crazy stuff against you. But God is telling us not to be malicious. Amen. This technology is telling me the definition of malicious. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So be kind. Listen, 32. Be kind and tender-hearted to one another. If there is anything that God wants us to do, is to be kind to one another, to be in relationship, to be in fellowship. This is the word of God. Be tender-hearted to one another. Listen, the last part. Forgiving each other just as Christ God forgave you. Amen.
Amen.
I love this. Forgiving each other just as in Christ God has forgiven you. Amen. So, we have some work to do. And as I finish, John chapter 9 verse 4, it says, while it is daytime, we must do the works of him who sent me. The night is coming when no one can work. He says, while I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. So there is work for us to do. Amen. There is work for us to do. And we need to do that work God has called us to do while it is still day. Because when the night comes, you're going to be asleep. Sleeping literally, but also sleeping in death. So you cannot do anything the moment you transition from here. It is done. Amen. So we need to do everything God has called us to do right now. Amen. And be the light just as Christ is the light and his light shining in us. Amen. And that at the end of the day, when he calls us, we are ready. Amen. So that is something I want to leave with each and every one of us today. So that when you're living your life, you don't live it carelessly. Mm-hmm. Don't live like, you know what, I got all the time in the world. No, you don't. Mm-hmm. Because you have no idea. Mm-hmm. Amen. The psalmist says, Lord, teach me how to number my days. Mm-hmm. Amen. None of us knows the day of the hour. None of us knows. If God is coming tonight, whether he's coming, you know, as we leave the building, whether we're going to find ourselves, you know, I was watching a video as I finished. This guy played a prank on his wife. I don't know if you've seen the movies about the rapture. You know, how it's going to happen. The body is going to be transformed. And how, when they show in the movies, so if you're putting on your clothes, all your clothes are going to stay right there. So this man had a wife. He has a wife and children. I don't know if the wife had gone to the gym or if she worked the night shift. So he went to the stairs and he put his clothes in a way that somebody was, you know, like standing up or sleeping. And there was clothes on the stairs, in the dining, in the living room. And the wife comes home and all the cameras are on. Like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. No, she's flipping. She's going through the phone, trying to call. Oh my God, oh my God. And she thought she had been left behind. So I don't want any of us, amen. I don't want any of us to be left behind. Amen. Because once it's done, it is done. So, to all our friends and the church members online, are you ready? Will you be ready when the Lord calls? Amen. So I want us to pray right now. And I just want to pray that God will help us to digest this word. You can play something, brother. Amen. God, help us to digest this word, and that we can think about all these things, and that we can act accordingly. Put away the foolish things, the child, the childish things, put them away and put on maturity and know that this is the time to do what we're supposed to be doing. Amen. This is the time to follow after God. This is the time to walk in holiness, in righteousness, because without holiness, no one will see God. Amen. And the scripture says in the last verse I'm going to read in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, and that God is going to come back for a church that has no stain or wrinkle. He says, and to present the church to himself as a glorious church without stain or wrinkle or any such blemish, but holy and blameless. Amen. That is the kind of church. And when I talk about the church, I'm talking about you, First Lady Palm. Amen. I'm talking about you, Sister Ruth. I'm talking about you, my friend online. You are the church. And the kind of church he's going to come back for is a church that is prepared. Amen. Don't be like those 10 brides who use all their fuel. And when the bridegroom came, you know, they didn't have any lights. We have to be ready and prepared. So when he comes, we are ready to go. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you so much for your word today. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that these words, oh God, will mean something in our hearts. Let these words, my God, mean something to us, oh God. Let these words, my God, go deep in our spirit and develop character, develop spiritual muscle, that from today moving forward, we shall live each day as if it is the last. Father, we thank you for the opportunity you've given us to hear it. And for everyone who's listening to this for the very first time, and they've never given their lives to you, God, we pray that you give them the grace and the ability to come to know you as their Lord and Savior. Father, I pray right now for those who are struggling, for those who are sick in their bodies, for those who are going through the death of a loved one, Lord. We pray for strength for them right now. For those who have sick people in the hospital, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus for healing, for strength, for restoration, and for purpose in their lives, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, for you are a God who hears. You are a God who answers prayer. Thank you for salvation for those who are receiving it today for the very first time. And if you are out there today, you've never given the Lord Jesus Christ your life, I just want you to touch your chest and say this prayer after me. Say, dear Lord, I come before you. I acknowledge that I am a sinner. I cannot save myself. Only you can save me. Please write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Make me a new person. Help me to serve you and to live a life that pleases you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much for tuning in with us. For those of you joining us on Facebook, YouTube, or Instagram, wherever, please go ahead and share this message with somebody else. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May His face shine over you. And may the Lord give you peace. We love you. This is the Guadalupe River Church, a place of healing, a place of restoration, a place of purpose. Join us every Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and Friday for prayer in the morning on Facebook, and also Bible study on Wednesday. The information is going to be on our Facebook page. And may the Lord bless you, keep you, may His face shine over you, and may the Lord give you peace. Amen.